All right, to wrap up this chapter, which is all about roots, radicals, we want to talk about something called rational exponents. Now, you know the term rational means a fraction in math. So basically, a rational exponent is a fractional exponent, and it's a radical. Okay, so it's a lot of language to throw at you, but it's pretty basic when you see the definition. So I have it written here that a to the 1 over n is the nth root of a. So let me give an example. So if I said, you know, the cubed root of x to the second, okay, that is equal to x to the 2 over 3 power. Okay, notice the 2 is your numerator and your fractional exponent, and the 3 is your denominator. So your root is really your denominator of that fractional exponent. And believe it or not, that's not just one more thing to throw at you and say, hey, you need to know this, but it makes working with these exponents or these radicals much easier in exponential form and in fraction form than it is in radical form. So these first problems, I'm simply just asking you to write these as a radical. Okay, we can do that. So this is the square root. Remember, if there's no number there in the index spot, you assume that's a 2. So really, there's a secret 2 sitting there with that square root. So this is going to be 3 to the 1/2 power. Now, where did I get the 1? Because that's 3 to the first underneath there. And then again, the denominator is always the index of your radical. Okay, so here I've got the cube root of y, so that's equivalent to saying y to the 1/3 exponent. Now remember, this 1/2 and this 1/3, those are just exponents. So if I were to type that in, that would be a superscript. Okay, so this is z to the 1/4, because again, the index of that radical is 4. That's my denominator, and what did I get the 1 from? That is z to the first underneath that radical. Now here they're asking us to do the opposite. All right, so I have 81 to the 1/2 power. Well, what that really means is I have an 81 underneath a radical, and the index of that radical is a 2. Now, the 2 is not really required, so if I were to type that in as a result, this is what I would type in instead. I put the 2 there just so you could see what was happening. And where does the 1 go? It's up here as an exponent, but 81 to the first is just 81. Okay, now we know the answer to that is 9, but that's not what the direction said. It just said write as a rational exponent. Okay, you know what? I got these directions backwards. I just realized that. I didn't read the directions. That's what I get for not reading. Write as a radical goes here, and write as a rational exponent goes there. I got all my problems mixed up. Oh well, I'm not going to fix it. You see what's happening. So let's write this as a radical. So this would be the cubed root, because that's my denominator, which means that's my root of 27 to the first power. And since it's to the first, I don't have to write to the first power. And finally, 16 to the 1/4 is called a rational exponent, but I'm supposed to write that as a radical. So that would be the 4th root of 16 to the first. So this is radical form, and this is a rational exponent. Again, to get these directions straight, and this is a radical. All right, so problem C, write as a rational exponent. Notice I have the directions right this time, okay? This is in radical form, the square root of 14x. I'm supposed to change that to a rational exponent. So that's going to be 14x to the 1/2 power. Now my question to you is, what's up with the parentheses? Why did I put them there? Well, the entire 14x is underneath the radical. Therefore, the entire 14x is raised to the 1/2 power. If you did not have parentheses there, it would not be correct. Because 14x to the 1/2, if I write it like that, means the only thing that's raised to the 1/2 is the x. And we know that's not what's going on. You definitely need the parentheses in this problem. So the 4th root of 7x, same story. I'm saying 7x is raised to the 1/4 power. And because it's both the 7 and the x, I need the parentheses. Okay, now this one, this 5 is in front of the radical. Okay, so I have 5, that's this 5, and then I have 6y to the 1/5 power. Again, why the parentheses around the 6y? Because all of that was under the radical, so it needs to be separated in parentheses and raised to the 1/5. The 5 that's in the front, the constant multiple, just comes down, and it is not in the parentheses. Now, notice the directions on D. It says simplify. Okay, so to me, when you simplify in this fractional form, it really is easier to think about it as a radical most of the time. 49 to the 1/2 means the same thing as the square root of 49, which we know is 7. So again, this is a rational exponent. This is radical form, and 7 is simplified. All right, so again, this is a rational exponent. If I rewrite that in radical form, that's the cube root of 27, and we know from the last section that the cube root of 27 is 3. Again, rational form, 16 to the 1/4. Radical form would be the 4th root of 16, and we know the 4th root of 16 is 2, because 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 is 16. All right? Example E says to simplify. Now look at the 3 separate problems for E. Look, they look almost just alike, right? But they're all different, so let's discuss in detail. This says the negative 64 to the 1/3. Again, this is rational exponent form. We know the denominator is the radical, so I have the cubed root. The numerator of the exponent is what this is raised to. So it's raised to the first power, so basically I can ignore it. And negative 64 goes underneath. Okay, now I need to simplify this. First of all, can I even simplify this? In other words, can you evaluate the cubed root of negative 64? Okay, you can do the cubed root of a negative. That's okay. It's the square or any even root of a negative that cannot be done. It would not be real. But an odd, if this is an odd or this is an odd number, a negative is okay. The next thing I have to deal with is the fact that, is 64 a perfect cubed? And see, 4 times 4 is 16 times 4 is 64. It is, right? So the cubed root of 64 is negative 4. Because again, negative 4 times negative 4 is positive 16 times negative 4 is negative 64. Okay, now let's look at our next problem. We'll do this in a different color to make sure this stays separated. This is the cubed root of negative 64, but notice no parentheses. So the only thing that's raised to the 1/3 power is the 64. So the negative goes in front, and then you have the cubed root of 64. So notice the difference, because in the first one, the negative's in parentheses with the 64. That goes underneath the radical. In the second one, the negative is not in parentheses with the 64, so the negative stays out front, and then the 64 goes under the radical. Now, when we simplify it, turns out we get the same result. The negative comes down, and the cube root of 64 is 4. Now, the last problem is entirely different, okay? This is 64 to the negative 1/3. Now, first of all, we don't deal with negative exponents. We make them positive. So way back a few tests ago, you'll recall a negative exponent means it belongs on the other side of the fraction bar. So these are equivalent. So 64 to the negative 1/3 is equivalent to 1 over 64 to the positive 1/3, which is 1 over the cubed root of 64, which is 1/4. Okay? So a negative with an exponent means something entirely different than a negative with the number. Now, let's handle that again, but this time I'm doing square root instead of a cube root. So these problems look all so similar, but they're very different, okay? So when I look at the first one listed here, I've got negative 64 raised to the 1/2 power. Again, this is a rational exponent form. We want to change that to a radical, so that is the square root. Remember, you could put the 2 there or not, but no number there or no index implies there's a 2, of negative 64. Now, we cannot take the even root of a negative number, so this is not real. Now, when you take a future math class, you will learn that that is an imaginary number. But right now, we don't have that definition, so we just say it's not real. Now, the next problem looks so similar, but the negative is not in parentheses with the 64. So the negative does not go under the radical, and this is the problem we have, okay? And I meant to do that in a different color. Let me help you out just a little bit. Let's change this to, let's just go with black. So negative the square root of 64. The negative comes down, and the square root of 64 we know is 8. So the answer to that is negative 8, whereas the answer to the square root of negative 64 is not real. That cannot be done. And then the last problem, we have a negative exponent. Remember, a negative exponent does not have anything to do with a negative number. When a negative is with the exponent, that simply means that that belongs on the other side of the fraction bar, and it makes that exponent positive. So this is in a numerator now, so it moves down to the denominator, and the negative 1/2 turns to a positive 1/2, which is the same as 1 over 64 underneath a square root. Right? And then the square root of 64 is 8, so 1/8 is the answer to that problem. So we're to write these as rational exponents. So remember, this is radical form. If I write this as a rational exponent, I'm supposed to change that exponent to a fraction. So this is x to the, remember, the numerator is your exponent. The denominator is your radical, and that's a square root. So this is x to the 5/2 power. Let's try it again. I've got a z is my base. The 3 is an exponent that goes in the numerator. The 4 is your root or your radical that goes in the denominator. And I'm finished with that one. And then y is raised to the 2nd power. But because it's under a radical of a 5, that goes in the denominator. So y to the 2/5 power. Now, these next problems I'm supposed to simplify. Now, these can be done without writing them in radical form, but whenever I have numerical values that are in this radical form, I think it's so much easier to simplify them first, or write them in radical form first and then simplify. So this is 9 to the 3rd power, but it's underneath a square root. Okay? Now, you have two choices. You can think about that as the square root of 9 to the 3rd, or you can think about it the way I have it here, as 9 to the 3rd under a square root. Now, what's always easier to me is to handle the radical part first. The square root of 9 we know is 3, so I did the inside first, and then 3 to the 3rd is 27. That keeps your numbers smaller, just like this one. The denominator, that's your radical. So I have the cubed root of 125. And then in the end, it's supposed to be squared. Now, I could square it first, but that makes my numbers bigger. Let's do the cubed root of 125 first. That's 5. And then 5 squared is 25. I'm going to write that a little bit neater. 5 squared looks real bad. There we go. Okay. And then here we go. The root is 4, so I have the 4th root of 81, but either before or after, I have to raise that to the 3rd power. And it keeps your number smaller if you do the exponent last. So the 4th root of 81, you have to remember, is 3, right? Because 3 times 3 is 9, 9 times 3 is 27, 27 times 3 is 81. So that's going to be 3 to the 3rd power, and 3 to the 3rd is 27. Alright, so these problems say simplify. Now, I want you to think about this fraction out here. That's an exponent, right? So this is like saying, let me write it where you might can see it, x to the 8th, and that's all to the 1/4. Sometimes seeing it like that makes it a little easier. If you'll remember, when you have a power to a power, you multiply those together. So I'm going to multiply 8 times 1/4. Okay, remember, you don't need a common denominator to multiply. You just need to, 8 times 1 is 8, over 1 times 4 is 4, 8 over 4 is 2. So this is equivalent to x squared. Let's try it again. So this is y to the 16 times 3/8. That's really what's going on. When you have a power to a power, you multiply. Now, I can simplify this 16 and 8 beforehand, because you think about that, that's 16 over 1. This 8 goes into 16 two times. 8 goes into 1 once. 2 times 3 is 6. Over 1 times 1 is 1. So that's y to the 6th power. Here, again, a power to a power, I multiply. So this is z to the 6th times 4 thirds. That 6 is over 1. I can simplify before I multiply. You can say 6 times 4 is 24, over 1 times 3 is 3, and then simplify. Or you can say, hey, 3 goes into 6 2 times, 3 goes into 3 once. And that's going to give me z to the 2 times 4 is 8, over 1 times 1 is 1, so z to the 8th. Y'all, that is so much easier than dealing with this in radical form. Okay, and that's what we did in the previous video. If you watched that, you probably felt like you were living a nightmare there for a minute. This is just easier. I know many of you don't care for fractions, but goodness, it's so much easier than trying to break down those radicals like we did in a previous section. Now, look at this. X to the 5/4 divided by x to the 3/4. Now, what are we supposed to do with these exponents right here when we divide? You remember we subtract them, right? So this is, let's pick a different color, x to the 5/4 minus 3/4. That's what's really happening. So this is x to the, now you do need a common denominator to subtract these. This is not a power to a power, right, where you can multiply and you don't need a common denominator. When you're dividing common bases, you subtract exponents, and to subtract fractions, you need a common denominator. So 5 minus 3 is 2/4. Which is x to the 1/2 power, and we're finished with that one. Now, this next problem, I got v to the 3/5 over x to the 2/5. Hey, careful. Don't jump in there too quickly. We cannot simplify this at all. I mean, you can rewrite it as a radical if you want to, but this is a v and this is an x. Now, honestly, when I type this up, I don't really know if that's what I had in mind or not, but that's as good as that gets. You can't do anything else with that. Okay, but look at the next one. Z to the 2/3 and z to the 5/3. I can do that one because they're both z's. So that's z to the 2/3 minus 5/3, which is going to be z to the 2 subtract 5 is negative 3/3. Continuing that down here, that's z to the negative 1. Now remember, a negative exponent means it belongs on the other side of the fraction bar, which is 1 over z to the first, which is really just 1 over z. Okay? Catch all of that? So again, z to the 2/3 over z to the 5/3. That would be z to the 2/3 minus 5/3. Okay? Which is z to the negative 3/3. We already have a common denominator. 2 subtract 5 is negative 3. I reduce the fraction, negative 3/3 is negative 1, but I'm not supposed to leave a negative exponent in my final answer. So that's why it's 1 over z to the first, which is 1 over z. Okay? So our last four problems of this video, and really our last four problems for all of the section and chapter on radicals. So here we go. We're supposed to simplify in parentheses 32x to the 1/4 all raised to the 4/5. Now, here's what that means. That means we have 32 to the 4/5 power, and we have x to the 1/4 to the 4/5 power. Now, this 32 to the 4/5, that's a numerical value, so to me that's easier to evaluate in radical form. So when I have numbers, I tend to go back to radical form, but when I have variables, dealing with the fractions is a little easier. So radical form, that means I have the 5th root of 32 raised to the 4th power. Remember, we talked about this, that you could do the root first and then the power, or you could do the exponent power first and then the root, but it's so much easier to do the root first because it keeps your values smaller. So if I continue with this, the 5th root of 32 is 2, and then you still have to raise it to the 4th. And 2 to the 4th is 2 times 2 times 2 times 2, which is 16. Now here, I have this x to the 4th raised to the 4/5. Remember, this means to multiply, power to a power. which gives me x to the 1/4. I'm going to literally write that down 4/5. Now, y'all, I can cancel this 4 and this 4 because it's multiplication. So that's x to the 1/5. And that gives me this answer. Now, that is in rational exponent form. Another appropriate answer would be 16/5th root of x to the 1st. That's radical form. So be careful with your directions. Your directions may want it in rational exponent form, which would be the first one, or radical form, which would be the second one. They're both correct. All right, let's try another one like that. So 64 is raised to the 1/3, and so is y to the 2/3, because that's in parentheses, that 1/3 applies to both. So I've got 64 to the 1/3 power and y to the 2/3 to the 1/3 power. The only reason I put parentheses around the y to the 2/3 is just kind of separate these fractions so it's not so confusing. Now, a number raised to a fractional exponent is easier to evaluate if it's in radical form like that. But this is a power to a power, which means multiply, so 2/3 times 1/3. The cube root of 64 we know is 4, because 4 times 4 is 16, times 4 more is 64, so that's 4. And then here I have 2 times 1 is 2, 3 times 3 is 9, so 4y to the 2/9. That is rational exponent form, or I could say it's 4 the 9th root of y squared, and this is in radical form. They're both correct. Just read your directions carefully. This just says simplify. So from that directions, I couldn't tell which way to go. But if you're doing homework, read the directions carefully. It's going to say either as a rational exponent, or it's going to say in radical form. So again, this is what we call a rational exponent, and this is radical. Okay, now let's keep going. I have all these x's raised to fractional exponents. Now, we know when we multiply bases, as in the numerator here, we add exponents. So I'm going to write this fraction now as x to the 2/3 plus 5/3. That's just how exponents work. And I'm going to rewrite the denominator as -5/3. We'll handle that in a minute. 2/3 plus 5/3. You need a common denominator to add. Lucky us, we already have it. That's x to the 7/3. Now, this x to the -5/3, we can move it to the numerator and change it to a +5/3. So now I have x to the 7/3, which is already in the numerator, times x to the 5/3. So I'm going to add those exponents together. I'm going to add 7/3 plus 5/3 together. I already have a common denominator, right? 7/3 plus 5/3 is 12/3. The fact is, 12/3 is just 4. So the answer to this is x to the 4th. Now, tell me I didn't lose you there. When you multiply bases, you add the exponents. So that's why I added the 2/3 and the 5/3 together. The -5/3 in the denominator is an exponent. I left it. And next, again, there's my 7/3 after I added. But I'm going to take this entire x to the -5/3 to the numerator. So now it's no longer in the denominator. As a matter of fact, the denominator is just 1. It doesn't fit at the bottom of my screen here, but it really is just a 1 underneath here. When I take it to the top, I'm adding together again the 7/3 and the 5/3 to get the 12/3. And then 12/3 reduces to the number 4, and then we're finished with that problem. Okay? And then finally, for our last problem, let's hope we have enough space. I've got 2 to the 3/4 and 2 to the 5/4. Okay, so let's make this 2. It looks like I was tired when I typed this up. This denominator here says x to the 1/4. Let's make it a 2, okay? So this is going to be 2 to the 1/4. All right, because if I leave the x down there, it just that's done with the problem. All we're doing is the numerator. I do really think I meant that to be a 2 down there instead of an x. So again, when you multiply bases, you add exponents. So I'm going to add 3/4 plus a -5/4. That's going to give me 2, and again, let me write down what I'm doing, 3/4 plus a -5/4. over 2 to the 1/4 down the denominator. Now, 3/4 plus a negative 5/4 is a negative 2/4. So I have 2 to the negative 2/4 divided by 2 to the 1/4. Now, I could reduce that 2/4, I know, to 1/2. But you know the rule, when you divide bases, you subtract the exponents. So it's easier to subtract when you already have a common denominator. Y'all, I'm going to go to the top of the page, and I'm going to say this is 2. Now I'm doing negative 2/4 minus 1/4. Again, remind you why I'm subtracting. I'm taking my numerator minus my denominator exponent. That's the way it works. So this gives me 2. Negative 2 minus 1 is negative 3/4. But I'm supposed to write that as a positive exponent. So that's 1 over 2 to the 3/4 power. And that is completely simplified. I hope this helps you out. I do think dealing with these fractional exponents is a little bit easier than the radicals, the higher order radicals that you had to simplify in the previous section, but they all of these take just plenty of practice. So make sure you practice these quite a bit, and I hope you have a great day. Bye-bye.